Go. Hello, everybody. How are you? I think we've got everybody in the room now. And we'll see some more coming on. So, thank you for coming again to the Distance Resistance. I hope some of you are, I'm sure some of you are returning guests, and then always a bunch of new faces, which I absolutely adore seeing. And I love saying hi to you guys and being welcomed by my old friend Matt Kemp, who's just joining us. So, thank you for coming. I'll tell you a little bit about what this evening's about, and then we'll get cracking with our amazing speakers from around the planet once again. I'm really appreciative that these guys have made the time to come and chat with us, and I do hope that you also feel that there's an opportunity for you to speak to them tonight. So it's this is supposed to be a kind of conversation, so we'll get stuck in. So we call this a distance resistance. You know why? It's we're apart and we're staying apart, but that doesn't mean we can't come together and kind of enjoy a bit of inspiration and come up with some new ideas and see some new faces. So. We've been doing this now for about 9 or 10 weeks, off and on, fortnightly, and with hundreds of tickets taken at various points in time. So it's been really fun to do that. I hope you've got a refreshing drink of your choice, depending on your time zone, and that you're ready to settle in for an engaging chat. But like I said, it's supposed to be fun and informal. So here's the deal tonight. I'm going to introduce our three speakers, and then one by one, we'll talk to each of them and then ask you guys to dive in with questions and some observations at the end. If you want to ask a question, you can mention it in the chat box, or you can raise your hand, and we'll try and get you on screen, because it's nice to see some new people. But we are recording this, so if you don't want to be on screen, hide your camera. I also wanted to thank Nick from Hyper Islands, like I always do, who is my amazing kind of maid of D in the back end, keeping things on a smooth keel and making sure it all works. So hopefully it works. Okay, tonight's theme is how not to screw up the culture. Everyone's talking about working in a remote world, but I really want us to talk about culture. And we started out really, there's an old blog post on Medium from, I think it was Brian Chesky, who's one of the founders of Airbnb, who said he'd asked Peter Thiel, that very famous thinker and writer and venture capitalist and founder of PayPal, what was the single most important piece of advice he had for him as he was launching his company or maintaining his company. He said, don't fuck up the culture. And I thought that was such a fascinating, it's been with me for years, that point. And suddenly we're in this situation where our cultures, our working cultures, our team cultures, our national cultures, never been more stretched. and I'm really interested to dig into that a bit more with you all and really sort of think that through. We often believe that a culture can be a competitive advantage. Like if you've got good people and they feel good and they've got a shared set of values and a point of view, then that can be a real distinct benefit against your competitors. And at Grey Consulting, this is my sell bit, we exist to make brands more competitive inside and out. So we're really interested not just in how you present yourself to the world or how you design relevant products and services, but more fundamentally how you actually run your business in a way that makes it more competitive. You know, a culture is an operating system that we like to work on. So, but if company cultures are being dissolved right now, question, if it's harder to have shared beliefs in an environment where we're not together, again, is that true or not? I don't know. Does that mean that customers are going to get a more inconsistent experience? Does it mean employees are going to lose heart for some company mission? Does it mean talent will be less attracted? That's what I really want to get into tonight. So let me introduce our three speakers to you and then we'll get into it. So first up will be Jason. Jason, you can say hello and see if your mic is still working.
Hello, is my mic still working?
Yeah, you're good. All right. I'll do a sentence on Jason and I'll let Jason tell you a bit more about himself really. But well-known founder and president of, co-founder and president of Basecamp, a Chicago-based company, and Jason's in Chicago right now, and will tell us a bit. I think, Jason, you can tell us a bit more about how the web-based productivity tools that you've built have really kind of changed the world. And also, best-selling author of the book Remote, Office Not Required, and a bunch of other ones, including Rework. So I'm really excited to find out a bit more about Jason. Jason, tell us a couple of lines about yourself.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, by the way. Well, yeah, so about 20 years ago, I started this business. We started out as a web design company, so we were just doing website design for hire. Kind of realized we couldn't manage our projects very well. We were just kind of scattered everywhere. No one knew what anyone was doing. We had deadlines, but no one knew what they were. We had client communication in a bunch of different places. We had internal communication in a bunch of different places. We couldn't figure it out. So we ended up building our own tool to solve that problem, which became Basecamp, which we launched about 16 years ago. We've pretty much been doing that ever since. So Basecamp is a tool. It's a collaboration tool, it's a team communication tool, it helps you keep track of all the work that's happening inside of a company, who's responsible for it, what needs to get done, when it needs to get done, what decisions have been made, and keep it all in one place. So you're not scattering communication across this chat tool and that email thing and this phone call and that in-person meeting and that Zoom call, but keeping it all in one place. That way you can actually figure out what the hell's happening versus like, where's that? Where do I go for that? Where do I put that? So we've been doing this for a while. And we're a remote company. We've been remote for 20 years. So we really understand what's going on right now. So I have a lot to say about that as well, if people are curious.
That's what I'm going to dig into. And in fact, it was one of our speakers on the last event, Bruce Daisley, that I think you've met before, who ran Twitter in Europe and has written a good book in the UK on, well, and in the States now, The Joy of Work, who put me onto you as a kind of perfect example of this. So thank you to Bruce for doing that. Our second speaker tonight will be Jochen Menges, who... is based in currently in Germany, but works in Zurich and Cambridge more normally. And I'm not going to do a fair description of you, Jochen, but we've already talked a little bit this week about some of your work in how to make the future of work more human as one aspect of it. And I found that really fascinating. So tell us a bit, Jochen. I'll just make sure you're unmuted. Tell us a little bit, Jochen, about what you do and what interests you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for inviting me on to this discussion here. I am a professor of leadership and human resource management and organizational behavior at the University of Zurich and at the University of Cambridge in the UK. So I'm living in and working in both of these countries and residing right now in Germany. And across, you know, over a decade of research and answers from over 100,000 people and hundreds of different firms and organizations, my research really shows one thing, and that is that emotions matter, and that is how people feel predicts really what they do at work, how long they stay, how hard they work, how much they innovate, and all of this other stuff. So one big question for me was, where do these emotions all come from? And one key ingredient in telling the answer to that question is, of course, in the organizational culture. And culture is created by leaders, but culture is also created by everyone in a business. So I'm really curious as to how cultures create these feelings that pervade us at work, and that infuses with the kind of energy that we need to get our work done, have our best ideas, and see things through. So really, this insight that emotions matter then has led me to ask, how do we create the future of work? With all the technology coming in, all of these new things, the robots, the artificial intelligence, and so on. And most of those visions that are out there for the future of work are really tech-centric. The work that I do is very human-centric, and I think we have to make the future of work work for everyone and make it very human.
I love it. So we're going to get into that today, and that's the key theme. And then Leonie, wonderful friend. I must say, I think Leonie was the first ever Grey Consulting client, pretty much. Took a punt on us, and we were very small. Leonie is a retail leader with, I guess, over 20 years, two decades experience working in famous retail brands, including Dunelm in the UK, Tesco, I'm sure many of you internationally have heard of, as well as working in a strategy consultancy before. And she has the dubious honor of helping out what's called in the UK HMRC, which is Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs, on their customer experience. So I'm interested to hear a bit more about that at some point. But she's also had a bunch of really quite heavyweight multi-channel transformation projects. But Leonie, if you're unmuted, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, I guess I've had 20 years in retail, and I think I probably spent the first 10 years of those really interested in the work and how the work got done and being quite efficient. In the last 10 years, I've become more and more interested in leadership, really, and how, as a leader in a retail company, you can create a really great employee experience as well as a great customer experience. And in the last couple of years, that's involved taking a leadership role at Dunelm, which is a homewares business in the UK, on mental health, and working out how you can enable people to really be themselves at work.
I love it. So we'll get into that today, I think, and talk about some of the practical experiences that you have had. So Jason, if you're up, we're gonna get stuck in a bit more now, if you're okay with that. I guess the products that you made were 20 years earlier than, and suddenly we're all suddenly arrived in your, I know, what was your past in a way. How has it made you feel, and what have you been surprised by?
I'm just happy for employees. People get to decide to, you know, or people have an option now, perhaps, to work from home. Mm. I think it's really liberating. It's a transition, or maybe it's a scramble for a lot of people trying to figure this stuff out. But I think it's great overall. And I think that, you know, anytime you can bust a myth, it's a good day. Yeah. And there's been this myth for a long time that the office is the only place the magic happens, that the office is a special place. It's a place. It's not special. It's a place. And people get together in that place. But you don't need to get together to do a lot of work. Some work, yeah, it's handy, but not necessarily required. And in fact, there's a lot of distractions that come from being together. So I like what's going on. And of course, our products help people work remotely. So that's part of it. But I'm just really happy that people are hopefully going to have some more choice moving forward.
Did you never have a kind of physical center for your crew? Or how did you do it?
We do actually have an office here in Chicago. Yeah. So let me give you a little bit of background. We have about 56 people in the company. They're spread across about 30 some odd cities around the world. So Europe, we've got people in the US, Canada, some people in Australia, Hong Kong, just had someone in South America who just moved up to the US. So we've had people all over the place. But we've always had a central office in Chicago. But even though we have about 13 people in Chicago, but even though we have 13, on any given day, there's two or three people in the office. So the office is really more like a co-working space, in that people come in a couple times a week, maybe, just to get a little bit of change up, and they mostly work at home. So yes, we have a physical space, but we're, I would say, 100% remote company all in, really.
Yeah. I love it. And I loved your assertion. I think it's in one of your books that work doesn't happen at work. It's one of the sort of nice sound bites. But what has been getting it so wrong for, well, about 200 years, I guess?
Well, there are some advantages. And certainly, of course, let's face it, some work does have to happen in person. Retail, a lot of retail work, restaurants, factories, that kind of stuff, right? Obviously, that has to happen in person. But a lot of information work simply does not. And, you know, the advent of technology has allowed this to happen. But also, it requires a different mindset and a different shift from managers and owners and executives to feel like, you know, historically it's been, if I can't see you, well, I don't know if you're working, and therefore I don't trust you. So I have to see you. And, you know, just seeing a body pound away at a keyboard doesn't mean anyone's working either. It's just like this whole notion that seeing someone means you know that they're working. It doesn't mean anything. It just means that they're there. Yeah. The only way to look to judge work is to look at the work itself, the work product itself. Of course, you know, there are other advantages to being together, in terms of camaraderie and some of the things, but you can simulate that and get pretty close to that in most cases. But ultimately you want to look at the work itself and not just the body doing the work. So that's pretty much possible if you're a writer, if you're a designer, if you're a programmer, if you're a consultant, if you're an accountant, if you're a lawyer, if you're, you know, whatever, pretty much all information jobs can be handled remotely. And when you need to get together, that should be the exception and not the rule. So maybe every once in a while you get together with a couple people to hash something out. But for the most part, you really shouldn't need to. And in fact, the thing I'd like to say about this is that the biggest problem I'm seeing right now with remote work is that people are trying to simulate the office environment remotely. That doesn't work. Like, you can't have, you don't, if you have meetings all day in the office, don't have them on video. Instead, like, this is an opportunity to break free from the way you used to work and cut back on meetings, give people more time to get their work done, give people more contiguous blocks of long stretches of time versus cutting people's days into tiny little chunks by having meetings and get-togethers and conference calls and someone tapping you on the shoulder and all the things that happen in a physical environment. You don't have to have those things anymore. And this is a real opportunity for enlightened companies, I think, to really change the way they work and become more resilient. And
it's really interesting.
Give people more time.
That hangover, isn't there, from people finding it very hard to abandon their habits and their past dependencies and the learning they've had from before. And you see it a lot, actually, in the old days when people first started doing advertising online. We mentioned this last week. They put TV ads onto the internet rather than really thinking about how would you actually engage someone in an interactive experience. So I guess it's kind of the same. We're now making the same mistake in office culture.
I'm glad you brought that up, because when I started getting into website design, which is like 95, 96, what people did was they brought, at the time, CD-ROM interfaces online, because that's just like, that was the previous interactive style designy thing that people were doing. So like, let's just port this. And this is what's happened. Whenever there's been a change, you port what you know, which is understandable. Like, there's nothing necessarily wrong with it as long as you don't keep at it. There's a transitional phase, but then you have to realize that this is different. The internet was different. Working remotely is different from working locally. It's not just that you're far apart. There's actually a different way to do things. And I think that that's the real opportunity here.
So if work doesn't happen at work, did work culture ever really get built at the office anyway?
It's a great question. Here's my feeling on culture. I have a different take. I don't think culture is actually something that you create. Culture to me is the byproduct of consistent behavior. It's in fact, to borrow like a term from the financial world, it's really like a 50-day moving average of how the company acts and how people act with each other, how people act towards each other. That's what the culture actually is. You don't create one and that you establish one and that's all you do. No, it changes. It changes every time you hire a new person, every time someone leaves the company, it changes. It changes based on the weather. It changes based on a whole bunch of different things. It changes based on projects and deadlines and clients you might work with. It changes. It's changing. It's ever changing. And so I like to look at it as like the last 50 days or the last 200 days. Like, how have we been as a group? What do we actually do? So it's not what you say. It's not what's on the wall. It's not what you hope it to be. It's what it actually is. And the best way to get a sense of what a culture is simply to ask somebody who works at the company. It's not to ask the head of this department or the head of the company or the group. It's, what is it like to work there? That's what the culture actually is. And whether or not that happens inside or outside, I think it's a mixture. Even when everyone worked together, it's still a mixture. People communicate outside of work, or they go get a drink after work, or whatever it is. That has a big part of it too. Influence on it.
That's good. And we'll come back to culture, I think, on throughout this conversation, obviously, but as we go with our friends Jochen and Leonie as well. Are you able to sort of pinpoint for us some of the hidden upsides to remote working that perhaps we might not yet have come across or might not be able to read in the signals that are coming at us?
Yeah, I think there's a number of them. Let's start tactically with the work itself. If companies work differently when they work remotely, and they have fewer meetings, let's say, people have more time to themselves and they have more contiguous blocks of time. You can get a lot more done in 2 hours that are contiguous than, you know, 8 15-minute blocks of time chunked between this task and that task and this conference call and that. Like, you want to have contiguous blocks of time to yourself. And once you do that, people can actually be a lot more creative and a lot more productive. So time is not equal. It's 15 minutes or an hour. There's an hour that's 60 minutes, that's more valuable than an hour that's 4 times 15. You know, that it's really important. So I think that's really one of the great opportunities. The other thing is that, in my opinion, there's no reason why people should have to work somewhere just because they live somewhere. Like, optionality is a good thing for everybody, I think. And if you're locked in place because maybe your husband or your wife or your partner has a job and they can't leave a city, and now you're only able to get a job in the same city that they're in because that's just what the only way people hire, you're really limiting your options, and it's really unfortunate. Then you get stuck in a place. I love the idea of remote work because people can work for whatever companies they want. Companies can also have a much better chance at hiring great people. The notion that the best people in the world are within a 20-mile or 20-kilometer radius of your home office, like, no, of course not. Like, there are great people all over the place. And having access to them and they having access to you and letting them move around in their life and not having to lose their job and you not having to lose them, this is a wonderful thing. And I think it makes everyone better off. So again, contiguous blocks of time, more long form writing, more asynchronous style communication, less real-time communication. Right now, people tend to just jump into chat or jump into a real-time conversation if they're in person. This is actually a terrible way to work. It's very hard to actually think things through when you have to talk one line at a time and be reacting to everything that's going on in real time. It's much better to write something up, disseminate it, and let people think it through, maybe even get back to you the next day. These are things that remote work affords, opportunities that it affords, that in-person work just doesn't afford. So I think those are some of the things that I'd like to call out at this point.
So there's going to be an amazing renaissance of efficient and effective and smart working by lots of workers, or not, I guess, depending on how much they jump on the back, get it right.
I also hope there's going to be a resurgence of considered writing, thoughtful long-form writing versus like just pecking away one line at a time and just jabbing people with lines. It's just like, that's not a way to share an idea. No. So anyway, I hope that's gonna happen too.
That's great. I was gonna ask you, what was I thinking? I guess I still sort of feel like I need to understand whether, okay, so maybe 56, 57 employees, Basecamp, and you know, you're an enlightened leader and the culture has sort of been geared around that from the beginning, so it's sort of self-fulfilling prophecy perhaps. Is that, do you think it's possible to, so WPP I think is 130,000 people, just that's one experience I have. Is it possible to do that sort of thing when you've got thousands of screens and that's the main point of interaction between people, do you think?
Well, here's the thing. 130,000 people are not interacting with each other every day anyway, right? So yeah, hopefully not. So really, you know, in almost every organization, there's teams that work together. Like, our teams are relatively small. Intentionally, we have teams of 3 people. That's like the maximum amount of people that can work together on any problem that we have.
That's interesting.
We do that for a number of reasons, and I'm happy to talk about that too. But 3 is our team size, but maybe someone else's team size is 15 or 20 or 30. Like, you're working inside that group mostly.
Yeah.
And yeah, you're working for a company, but you know, the company itself, like person 122,000 is not really talking to person 13,000. Like, it's just not the way it works. So you're working in pods or teams, and I think that this absolutely can work. And if you need to do like an all hands kind of thing and you really need to communicate to 130,000 people, like, well, writing something up is one of the best ways to do it, or recording a video and disseminating that is one of the best ways to do it. There's really no other way unless you rent out a huge massive stadium, which we're not doing anymore anyway. So if you need to talk to everybody, you do it the same way. And it's small teams though can really benefit from this kind of working.
So I think that's very exciting. The idea of maybe companies made up of smaller units, pods, and sort of a slight unraveling or undoing of the Industrial Revolution's urge to go and all sit in big cities like Chicago, like London, like, you know, New York, like everywhere else around the world, that maybe we're moving to a really interesting time. And I think post-pandemic there was, or post-Black Death, there was the renaissance. Maybe this is the moment of a kind of renaissance of a new kind of more productive work culture. Perhaps someone will use Basecamp to invent perspective or whatever the modern version of that is. That'd be amazing. I'm going to come back to you, Jason, in a little bit.
Of course.
And certainly there'll be lots of questions at the end, but conscious of time, so we'll jump on to Jochen. Thank you, Jason. Jochen, are you okay? You can speak. You got your mic on?
Yes, just put it on.
So you mentioned in the introduction at the beginning, you've written extensively on the theme of making the future of work more human. And there's a lot of sort of, we're all in a bit of a state of wonder at the moment about the power of this collaboration technology, and my grandparents are Zooming, grandparents are Zooming grandchildren like never before and all the rest of it. But in all this sort of wonder and bemusement of what's happening, what are we failing to spot? What's missing?
So I think what's missing in all of that a bit is that for us to really feel something, it's best to be physically close to other people. Mm. And this co-regulation of emotion is something that's really special for us human beings. You know, we're hurt people. We're not loners sitting, you know, in our huts isolated from everyone else. We're hurt people. We've gone out to form, you know, families. We've gone out to form organizations. We've gone out to build cities. We've gone out to do things together. Mm. And we do things together because it feels safe to be in the proximity of others. It feels great to be with others. And even if we have to suffer, it feels less like hardship when there are others who suffer too. Yeah. So the sheer presence of others, you know, the proximity of the warmth of the hurt, that is what's currently lacking. And many of us who are currently at home, isolated, perhaps all alone, or perhaps at least not together with colleagues, maybe together with family members who have other agendas, other concerns, other demands on us, but not colleagues who share the same goals. That being all alone on our mission is something that sounds a bit heroic, like in the final episode when everyone else has died and you're the lonely hero climbing to the top of the mountain and, you know, saving everyone. But the truth is, we can't do this every day. And currently we're doing it every day, all day.
Yeah.
So there is an issue in this remote world of work that doesn't tap into our human need to be with others. And I think this is one of the concerns that perhaps is left with respect to technology, is that technology is great for all sorts of things, but it doesn't seem to yet give us that ability to feel it.
Yeah, so I think that's really interesting, that the sort of lack of the triggering of our mirror neurons in our brains and making us kind of emote with each other. Do you think, is it something which has to be physical? So I was, when we were putting this together a few weeks ago, then one of the quotes that I saw was from an author called Priya Parker, American author and TED speaker, who really talks about that she's kind of very, very interested in live events and bringing people together. But she says that gathering matters because it's through each other that we figure out what we believe, which I can understand that. I think there are times when we've all been swayed by the crowd, for better or worse. I mean, there are examples of us being swayed by the crowd in a bad way. But nonetheless, do you think that that has to be a physical thing? Or can we do it another way?
Well, we can certainly do it online for some time. We have been doing it online. There's all sorts of ways to bring us together. You know, I've attended a funeral, I've attended a wedding, I've attended a university-wide meeting and all of these things. They're all great, except for that still people, you know, feel a sense of loneliness once the call is over. Chook! And the call ends and then there's silence. Yeah. And, you know, there isn't really that feeling of connection that remains. And I think, you know, it shows that, just as Jason has said, you know, we might not need either extreme. You know, if we are all sort of like at home, you know, this also is an artificial situation, right? We enjoy times when we are at home, you know, the solitude of having time to get one thing done, as Jason has said, the sheer luxury of being able to focus in the absence of distraction is something we all enjoy. But equally, we all enjoy the proximity of the other, the warmth of the herd, you know, the connection with people. You know, that's why we go to concerts, that's why we go to stadiums, or at least used to go to stadiums and so on. It is much more fun to watch football in the proximity of others than by yourself, you know? So there is a balance to be struck between solitude on the one hand, the ability and freedom to work remotely, and connecting and relating and having a social life on the other hand. And as human beings, we need both.
Yeah, I guess we're going to end up with one of those things where both sides of the discussion are kind of, you know, valuable. Tell me, I mean, I guess I want to unpick some sort of basic stuff with you, because I think, you know, you're the expert and I'll be interested to understand. And I'm sure the rest of us will be in a similar feeling on the call. But is a company or an organization's culture a source of competitive advantage?
Oh, yes. Oh, almost definitely. At least it can be. There's, you know, decades of research that show that culture really predicts lots of outcomes that organizations care for. Innovation is one thing, you know, to the extent that the culture is open, collaborative, vision-driven, fast. These organizations tend to be more innovative, sell more innovative products. Sales is driven by culture because positive cultures lead to higher customer satisfaction.
Yeah, right.
Satisfied customers spend more. All the HR stuff is, of course, largely driven by culture. Whether I even want to work in a place starts with the kind of culture that I perceive that place to have. Whether I want to stay there depends on the kind of culture that, that pervades us and so on. But these are all the positive things. The idea is still that culture can also turn against you, because culture is also a barrier, for instance, to change, right? So strong cultures really sort of try to keep traditions going. They give us the kind of stability that we need. And they oftentimes then prevent the kind of change that is also needed. Cultures also are often making it difficult for organizations to merge and acquire other organizations. They're difficult when it comes to issues of diversity. All of these things are the downsides of cultures. So yes, culture can be a competitive advantage, but it depends really on the kind of culture that you have and the extent to which it is actually aligned with your strategy.
And I, you know, because I guess I asked the question believing, of course, that it is, but I just thought it was worth unpicking it. And it's good to get, like a primer on the power of culture. And I think it makes sense to me, although it always feels very hard to grasp and define. I like the way Jason defined it as a 50-day moving average. I thought it was very interesting. I guess one of the things that that comes to mind then, I suppose, is if culture is so important, what it always seems to me that cultural investment by an organization is very low. So yeah. We might sometimes moan in the marketing industry that people don't, you know, businesses don't spend enough on brands and marketing. Of course we say that. It's a tax on doing business, maybe. But actually there are people then, if you think about investment in internal communications and employee engagement and all those activities, I think they're probably struck off even early in advertising off the kind of budget list when times are tough. Why do firms, and maybe, you know, Jason and you might argue that's not the way to build culture anyway, and I take that as read, but why do organizations not value it enough and not invest enough in it? Why isn't it the number one thing?
Because it's so intangible. You know, it's very difficult to grasp. Culture is difficult to capture. It's so implicit, you know, and most organizations really rely on their formal structure, on the formal stuff that you actually can put on paper. But culture is something that you live. It's, as Jason has said, it's not something that's on the wall or written in a document or posted on the website or something. It's what people experience work to be day in, day out. And there are two things that make the culture of a place. The first thing is the people. So there is this idea that the people make the place, right? Yeah. Who you hire is what your culture is like. But then the second idea is that the place makes the people. And that means that how you configure your organization, what kind of stories you tell, what kind of narratives you have, what kind of material symbols surround you, what kind of rituals you engage in on a regular basis, and so on. These kind of things can also affect people in ways that change people in the way that they better fit with the culture. So these two drivers, as well as on one hand, you know, it's the people that make the place, but it's also the place that makes the people, is what, you know, is at the heart of what culture means. And because, you know, it's hard to change people. And if people make the culture, then, you know, organizations resist on doing that necessarily. And if it's the place that makes the people, then that requires quite a bit of investment that needs to be done and rolled out throughout the whole organization to change the whole culture and so on. And then it's slow, and then you never know how people respond and so on. So it's a tough thing to do.
Yeah. Do you think that, because if you're being provocative, and this is a conversation we're having earlier today in preparation for the, you know, this event tonight, someone was saying, my friend Tim, if that was saying, and he was being provocative, but you could assert that actually many companies are doing okay despite this remote working world. And maybe it's maybe I admit it's a bit too soon to say, right, what's going to happen, and perhaps it just proves Jason was onto the right thing all along, really. But maybe that would suggest that very connected, physically connected, personal shared culture is actually overstated in its importance. What's your take?
That may well be the case. I mean, culture is something that is happening at the collective level, right? It's not that an individual creates a culture or maintains a culture. It's what we do collectively, and what we believe in is appropriate as a group of people. And so for that to happen, people have to come together and people have to somehow converge on what they believe is appropriate. Now, you can do this two ways. One is you hire people who have the same values, have the same approach to work, have the same kind of personality and so on. In this case, of course, you know, you get a bunch of people who can work wherever they are, and they all stand for the same thing and all predictably behave in the same way.
Yeah.
You know, there is other ways in which you can also think about culture. And this is this other way of sort of creating a place in which a culture emerges through the kind of exposure people have to the office space, to the others that are there, to the leaders that act as role models and that people want to copy and imitate in their behavior and so on. And that requires, you know, a bit of time together. Not every day, you know, 10 hours a day or whatever it is, but it does require exposure.
Yeah.
And co-presence. And that's why I believe that, you know, even though, you know, many businesses might be dealing well with the remote world of work, we will see a return to some extent to the office. Now, what I do think is a benefit of having been in this sort of like remote world is, yeah, is two things. One is ironic, you know, it's the fact that, you know, our constraint on freedom actually will free us up later to, as Jason has said, to be liberated, to make some more choices ourselves as to where do we want to work, when do we want to work, how we want to work, and so on. So I think the very constraint and lockdown in which we are in is going to free us later, because now we know it can actually work. And as you said, Leo, it has worked. And the second thing is that I think this world of work, the working from home, has really sort of brought us into an area of, into an era of authenticity. You know, on these calls, I see rarely a person wearing a tie or stuff like that. You know, there's like all of this formality of the office environment is gone. You know, it's like, you know, in the past, it was inappropriate, in culture terms, inappropriate to take your children to work. Now they pop up and crash Zoom calls regularly.
Yeah.
You know, in the past, it was unthinkable for people or inappropriate to work from wherever they wish to. Now it's the new normal. So I think, you know, there are ways in which we are seeing a window of opportunity for culture change to happen through these external shock that we're all going through.
So are you, as an academic, researching, you know, corporate environments, corporate cultures, organizational behavior, you must be super excited in a way about the kind of massive experiment we're all undertaking at the moment. Is there, what is the, amongst your peers and the guys that you're really inspired by and excited by talking to, present company accepted, what is the kind of desire or excitement that they are all looking to kind of uncover in the coming months and years ahead?
I think there is a realization that, you know, while the focus has been for a long time on customer centricity and how to, you know, so be the best for the people who buy stuff from you, this crisis has really propelled us into a time of employee centricity, where businesses focus inward and look at, you know, how do our people deal with this? How do we get people through this? How do we give them the kind of support they need at home now to get the job done? And this reshifting of attention towards the inside and to looking at your employees in a new way, not as human resources, but as people, you know, this, I think, has changed organizations fundamentally. And from the leaders that I talk with, from those people who are in CHRO and CEO positions, they tell me that that's their new focus. Employees second, people first.
That's really interesting. So that'll play nicely into your school of work you're doing on HR Valley or People Valley, I guess.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, the HR Valley is sort of this idea that, you know, while there are plenty of valleys on this world that are concerned with tech, the future of work really needs a valley concerned with people. And so we're trying to create this HR Valley in Zurich. If you look up hr-valley.ch, you get a glimpse of our sort of like initial prototype website. We're all building this as we speak, so give us a bit of time to sort of shape things up. But I think we really need a place where people come together to think about what the future of work looks like from a people perspective. Not another tech valley, not another, you know, bunch of coders, but a bunch of people who think of how do we want technology to be, to elevate us as people, and how do we make this future of work for all of us. So that's the idea behind the HR Valley.
So maybe when we finish on our conversation, you could drop the URL into the chat and people can access it from there. I was going to ask you one final question before we move on to Leonie, and then we'll come back to the floor at the end. But I was going to say to you, like, if I can ask you to imagine or envision this sort of new world of work that you would like, or that you think would be good for organizations and for people, maybe semi-remote distributed work culture, but that also is co-present times. Tell us what you think it looked like. So what would you like to see in your dream?
So what I see is two things. The first thing is that one size fits all is over. This idea that, you know, everybody has to work remotely, or everybody has to be in the office, or everybody has to do this or that, or, you know, happiness initiatives that cover everyone the same way, that's over. We realize in this crisis that some people work effectively from home, others don't. Some people want to do this forever. Others want to return to work the first moment that's possible, right? So there is difference in people, and we are all different. You know, this is the richness of our diversity. So we can structure organizations in ways that create the same type of deal for everyone. So I'm hoping that this new world of work is one where we're recognized and appreciated as individuals, and where we take employee experience as a slogan to a new level that includes human experience, and that we are free to be the ones that we truly are, and that our organization supports us, knowing that when we are who we truly are, we give our best. And this is the second thing that this crisis has shown. And this brings me back to how I started, Leo, actually.
Yeah, right.
It is really that emotions matter. You know, in this crisis, even the C-level people have realized that emotions are not just a matter of retention and well-being, but emotions are at the core of our productivity. If we don't feel well, we don't produce. They're a core of our creativity. If our life sucks, we don't have good new ideas. So emotions are really important. And if emotions are important, then it's a question of who can handle them well. Well, it's people who have a skill set. The skill set is called emotional intelligence. So we need more attention to developing not just, you know, science, technology, engineering, math, these kind of things. We need human skills, emotional intelligence. And we need organizations to invest not just in another coding camp, but also in an empathy camp. And if we do all of that, then we'll have more emotional intelligent people in organizations. But they can't do their magic unless the organizational culture changes. So what we're currently working on is, what does it mean for an entire organization to be emotionally intelligent? How do we build an emotionally intelligent culture where this kind of behavior, this kind of skill set is something that's naturally endorsed, appreciated, and shared? So we're looking at how to translate every single aspect of what organizations are like into something that works for people, creating hopefully one day, and perhaps that day is not too far away, emotionally intelligent organizations.
That's an amazing place to stop. I think I'll thank you, Jochen. That's really fascinating. And I feel liberated by Jason, and I feel inspired, and that my individualism will be recognized by Jochen, and there's a positive future ahead. So Leonie, help me make sense of some of this and put the practical head on a bit. Not that these guys aren't practical, but I thought we'd maybe kind of have a chat about some of your experience of building and running, you know, big size teams in the retail environment. I can't see Leonie on the thing, but are you there somewhere?
I am. I can see you.
Perfect. There you go. So Leonie, tell me, I mean, you've run big teams in lots of different locations. What sort of things have you experienced, and what experience have you got, I guess, of start again, what are practical ways in your experience that you can really kind of foster a team spirit and a team culture in the company?
Well, I would agree with Jason that it probably can be done very well remotely as well as physically. I think just the fact of the matter is a lot of organizations that are going through this process at the moment will have done it through physical connection and proximity to each other, and that therefore they won't be brilliantly well set up to replicate their sort of cultural cues and dynamics in a remote environment. So if I think about when I joined Dunelm, the homewares business in the UK, where I was leading a team probably of sort of 150, 200 people for a few years, you know, all of the cultural cues that I got when I joined were physical cues, really. And they were all about how people treated each other. You know, people held open the doors. I remember being overwhelmed by the courtesy in the business. They treated everyone, whether they were at the top of the business or, you know, on reception or, you know, the back door, in the same way. And I got a really clear sense of what the organization was about from that. Yeah. And so I think you lift a culture that's really around how people treat each other and sort of very rapidly overnight dump it online, because luckily you've got the technology to be able to do that. And there is real risk of dilution. And I think it will take really conscious leadership to navigate through that.
I've always thought, and if I remember going to Dunelm to see you, that the reaction you got from the people, the very first people you met, was I've always thought it's a really leading indicator of the culture you're about to walk into. I'm not quite sure where that exists in a Zoom-based, or that's unfair, but in a collaboration software world, like how do you replicate some of those? Because those things are important, and maybe they're not important. Maybe it actually doesn't matter anymore. Maybe you don't need a receptionist if you don't have a physical engagement. But how does one go about recreating some of those nonverbal cues and rituals in a remote world?
Well, I guess you have to create the time and the space for it. So you have to make sure you're not being just fundamentally task-oriented, but you create. And you know, lots of teams who work across multiple locations, even in very traditional organizations, have long done this on the various tech tools that are around, like Slack and, you know, other things where you can have really great chat channels that are much more informal, much more social, and less about getting the job done. So I think it's possible. I think you just probably have to be very deliberate about it to make sure that you recreate these things. I think the other thing that really has struck me about the last few weeks is I think the role of the leader in an organization is quite fundamentally changed by remote working. So I would bet that Jason's organization and many organizations where remote working is sort of de facto are much less hierarchical organizations. And, you know, in a physical environment, the leader is often the person that starts the meeting, who sits at the head of the table, who navigates through the conversation. And in a remote working environment, you know, there is a shift in that power base. I think, you know, the positives are that you've got far fewer of those sort of power cues. And so it can be much more democratic, more egalitarian. You probably hear from, you know, people probably much more confident to speak up, because, you know, if you look at all of us now, I guess we're all in the same size box on the screen, right? There isn't one person who's higher up or looks more important than anyone else. Mm. I think there are some real advantages. I think the disadvantages for leaders, and the things that I've always worried about with remote working, is that leaders are just less accessible, you know, and certainly in the culture, in organizations where I've tried to create a really positive culture, loads of that has been about being visible, approachable.
Yeah, talking floors.
Yeah, spontaneous with my time and providing people with loads of recognition in a non-verbal sense. You know, it's just the smile as you go past someone, or the quick thank you as you're going down the stairs. And I think I'm sure that is missing. It's almost like the
social niceties or something.
Yeah, it reminds me of like 20 years ago when bosses had office doors that were panelled wood and they were just shut, you know. And I think remote working really, there's a danger of that being reintroduced if you don't really break down some of those barriers and do some of the more creative things that Jason's probably done and others have done in remote.
More about, I'm really interested in this idea of hierarchy, and particularly, I guess, because they're male hierarchies. So many cultures still, unfortunately, are dominated by male hierarchies. Do you think that the advent of a more egalitarian sort of remote-based world could change that? Do you think that has an impact from a kind of, is there a gender-based impact in respect to that?
Well, I guess I certainly think in any one situation, it's harder remotely for one person to be terribly dominant.
Yeah.
And so I think that's helpful. I think probably both Jason and Jochen, though, made the point that the flexible working, I think it's a massive accelerant for women and female careers. So we've sort of broken down this barrier that suggested that, you know, various people, if they wanted to work more flexibly, and it is often women when they have families, you know, they're fundamentally unable to do that because organizations just aren't set up to it. And so one of the things I would hope for from this is that it really is a massive accelerant for women so that they can work more flexibly. Everyone knows it can be done. Everyone's had a window into each other's lives. guys are juggling childcare just as much as women are in the current crisis. And I think that's really exciting for women and for anyone that found it difficult to get to an office for 9 to 5 hours, frankly.
That's very interesting, actually. I think my own personal experience of being present for putting the kids to bed every night rather than commuting back on the train or the tube or something or the subway is quite fascinating in that respect. So that sounds very hopeful. People have been talking about how the countries with female leaders doing much better at handling their pandemics. Maybe it's because they're somehow more suited to remote government, or I don't know, maybe there's something happening there. Or
maybe they're more used to chaos and juggling things in their lives generally. I don't know. I'm not trying to come across as I don't know. I'm a massive feminist, actually, if I'm honest. But I think maybe women are able to, they've been juggling this stuff for years and now everyone's juggling it. And that's a really democratic thing.
Yeah,
it's a massive leveler.
Or it brings out more of it makes all of us men, I guess, but emphasize more those aspects of our personality that we've been able to kind of park on the side or not take responsibility for a long time. So that's kind of interesting. I mean, you know, what you heard from Jason and what you heard from Jochen, I'm thinking about, based on your very real and practical experience of a company of, 150, 160 plus in your team, but bigger organizations than that, how practical do you think what you heard it is in your experience?
I think it's really exciting to look at companies that have built themselves in that way or have made that leap. I think that Jason will be dead right, that loads of companies at the moment are probably just trying to replicate the office online. Like, I talk to loads of friends at the moment who they're just fried by the end of the day because they've done 8 hours on Zoom. So I think at the moment, whilst everyone's remote working, we probably aren't really doing it properly. It's going to take some real, and everyone's been in a crisis, by the way, like it's not exactly been peacetime. So I think it's going to take some real thought to work out how to properly adapt organisations to flexible working with a much higher proportion of remote working. And I think there'll be lots of people that need taking on that journey. I mean, there are millions of people in the UK who are furloughed at the moment and who simply haven't had that experience. So as you start bringing organisations back together, you've really got to think about all of those different groups and how you can set them up for success, because there'll be a bunch of people who just, for the last 10 weeks, they haven't been part of that transformation.
Yeah. Do you think if you were running a big retailer, that you'd be very concerned about or not about your ability to kind of... So, and I get the point that was made earlier by Jason and others that work culture is a moving feast and it depends on behaviours, and behaviours define it and they change depending on who you've got and what situations you face. But if you're running a big retail like a Tesco or a Dunelm, do you think people would be worried about the ability to convey a consistent experience to the customer at the end? Are they thinking, well, things are dissolving, things are falling apart, I don't have the same level of influence, or maybe they never did, but do you think they'd be worried about that, or where's your head at on that stuff?
Yeah, I mean, retailers and hospitality businesses have always been sort of fundamentally distributed models with what accounts as small teams working remotely anyway. So I don't think the current crisis sort of changes that particularly, to be honest. That is always a problem. Trying to deliver a consistent customer experience is always a challenge. And it is a lot to do with the culture and how you treat your employees, really. And the attitudes and the values and the behaviours that you demonstrate that you really, really care about. So not just painting it on the walls, but, the leaders live by and everyone else does.
Yeah.
I don't think it matters too much if the central team are working remotely or are co-located, that challenge.
Okay, no, that's really good. I guess it's obvious that those businesses have always been distributed in some way, had to deal with that challenge. In a few minutes, I'm going to ask... open the floor up for questions, and either you guys can ask each other questions, or I'd like to be able to ask some of our guests and in the audience to come and ask some stuff themselves, and you can come on screen. But I was going to ask you one final thing, Leonie, if you don't mind, which is, and it's a bit of a sort of, you've got to, it's a bit imagination required, I suppose, really, but what do you think we're failing to spot about the impact of remote working on cultures right now that we'll come to feel quite strongly about in 1 or 2 years' time? And when we look back on all of this, what will be the thing we'll say, oh shit, we didn't spot that? What might be one of those things?
I think there are probably a couple. One thing that I've heard people say is that they're not really getting that sort of agendaless time at the moment, which is really, really powerful, where you come together and you do the big creative thinking through connecting properly. And that might be because of the crisis, really, rather than because of remote working. But I do worry a bit that that's a miss. I think the other thing is that there are going to be some individuals for whom this is really tricky. So in the last couple of years, mental health has been ever more important in organisations. And I think that's just certainly the way probably a lot of organisations are having to operate at the moment, just less visible. So, you know, whilst there will be some people, like Jochen said, who thrive with remote working and are really active participants, and you can't miss them on a bloody Zoom call. I think there'll be other people who feel really invisible and for whom they feel a bit lost, really. And I worry about the development of those individuals and how they feel. And that's much more, you know, I think mental health as we go through this and lots of people are at home is a massive, massive issue. I think it's probably quite difficult for companies to tackle it currently. And it's a real watch out.
Yeah, I think you're probably right about that, unfortunately. Okay, I think we're going to go to the floor for some questions. So I've got a couple to, I'm going to ask whether, Audrey, I saw you asked a nice question. Would you be happy to come on screen and ask your question? Can everyone see Audrey's question in the chat? Nick, I don't know if you can find her.
Hello.
Hi, Audrey. How are you?
Hey, good. All good.
You want to ask your question? I'd love to hear what you were thinking.
Any thoughts on the process of emotional contagion between leader and followers, especially through computer-mediated communication?
So what do you mean by, when you say emotional contagion, what are you thinking?
It's a process that that goes on between two communicators, and in this case, leadership, for leadership, leaders and followers. Mm-hmm. So it's a special, I'd say, an emotional process that goes on between two speakers that, you know, it's not easy when you talk to someone and that person don't actually get what you mean, because most of our conversation is mostly verbal, but through computer mediated communication, I wonder if it's going to have an impact like throughout this pandemic.
Yeah.
Okay. And in the future.
Does anyone want to take Jason and Jochen? Jason, do you want to have a pop at that? Do you fancy having a go at that question? We say have a pop at that question in England, but that's maybe a bit strange, but do you fancy a pop at that?
Sure, I'll try. I think the root of it, if I'm understanding it correctly, is nonverbal communication missing, or a lot of communication is nonverbal. Can you pick it up, remotely? Can you pick it up through technology the same way you could in person? And I don't think you can. I don't think it's the same. But we don't need things to be the same. I don't think we should be measuring things on, are they identical to the way we're used to it forever? Like, things are changing a little bit and we all have to get used to that. The same thing was true. Like, could you imagine someone walking with a phone and talking to the air, like, you know, 25, 30 years ago? No. Like, then people got used to people wearing cell phones. Then people got used to wearing earbuds and like people are talking to themselves all day long, which would be super weird before. So it does take some time for these things, transitions to happen, and it's going to be different. But I think there's some great points by Leonie, especially around like physical communication can also be really intimidating, and it can also be there can be a physical presence that makes it difficult for certain people to speak up. Either they feel threatened, they feel intimidated, or whatever. In any case, and this is a little bit of a great equalizer in a sense too. It there's costs and trade-offs with all these things, and I think that's the important thing to keep in mind, is everything has a trade-off. So we can say, is it as good as this? No, not in this capacity, but perhaps it's better in these other ways. It's just a blended situation. But I do agree that communication is not quite as, let's call it, rich this way. But also, it just sort of is what it is. And I think that if there are moments when a really true rich conversation needs to happen, then I think getting in person, if possible, is better. But here's the other thing, last thing I'll say about this is that there's a lot of conversations where a rich interaction doesn't need to happen, yet it happens far too often. People are distracted in real time. When they're in physical office, people are pulled into meetings they don't need to have. They're pulled into conversations they don't need to be part of. There's a meeting room with eight chairs around it, so you fill up eight chairs when only three people needed to talk, but now you've got eight chairs. So it looks weird if it's empty, but online, you don't have these eight empty boxes staring at you. You just have who's here. And so there are a lot of situations where the rich conversation is actually not an advantage, it's a disadvantage. So we can't just assume that we always need to have more higher fidelity conversations. Sometimes the too much fidelity is not really valuable either. So, but yeah, anyway, fundamentally, it's all different. It's gonna be different. We're all gonna figure it out over time. But I think looking back 20 years, or looking forward 20 years, if you're 20 years forward looking back, people won't think it's odd. It'll just be like the way it is.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of what happens to most things.
That's super interesting. Jochen, have you got a thought on that ability to create emotional contagion or through?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, sort of like there's a whole science around emotional contagion because it's such a fundamental process by which we feel. Because as I said, oftentimes how we feel does not depend on us, but it depends on those who are around us. And they pass on those emotions to us by way of emotional contagion. Now, what the research shows is that emotion contagion works very well online. It works on a massive scale through social networks. There's been a scandalous study of Facebook manipulating your feed. The author of that study is Kramer, if you look it up. It shows that actually you can very much sort of infuse people with feelings just by sort of altering the newsfeed to feed more positive or more negative messages to you and images in those categories. So I think emotion contagion actually does work very well online and it does scale up. But the trouble is that, you know, you are left alone as the person on the receiving end. And so you're very susceptible to this emotional contagion from those who expose you to this kind of emotional message. And we seek out those emotional messages, but then we need to sort of like negotiate our response to them. And when we're in a meeting, you know, we oftentimes look left and right and someone rolls their eyes and, you know, it's easier to sort of like sort out what's the real sort of way to deal with this. Then when we're just looking at a screen, not knowing, you know, how to perhaps deal with what we're just seeing. And so I think, you know, emotional regulation in the context of emotional contagion is something that we sometimes forget and that we need to be cautious how to defend ourselves against this kind of emotional influence and be able to really sort of distance ourselves from the emotional contagion to which we're all exposed every single day. Through the social networks, as well as through, of course, kind of meetings we hold online. Emotional contagion can be something that's joyful if we're exposed to positive things, but it can also be something very threatening if we are at the receiving end of negative stuff.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. And someone talked to me recently about how they weren't going to take some time off because we can't go anywhere. They were going to take some time offline. That was their, but I think that's a form of their defense against the intensity of this experience at the moment. And I know it sounds obvious, but I thought that was quite interesting. Leonie, perhaps we could ask another question to Leonie, and I know someone, Suzanne, for Leonie and Jason maybe, but a nice question. Do you want to come and ask it, Suzanne? I can probably unmute you, I think. Yeah, there you go.
Hi, everyone. Hi. Yeah, really interesting. I'm sitting here nodding and smiling to the last comments. I work for British Airways, and meetings were... Right. Incredible, you know, and that was a really damaging emotional contagion between meetings. But my question would be, how do you get the right kind of online, the right kind of contagion? You know, we have online drinks, which are so unsatisfactory. I mean, it's dire, you know, everyone wants to leave. You've got quizzes where, you know, it's almost like a, people are testing each other's intelligence and, you know, that kind of really damaging, trying to outsmart each other. I want to know if you've got any real good tested, this works. And that's pretty much to Jason, I think, because you're the 20 years in.
Yeah, you know, I think what your descriptions are right, and I think people are just trying to figure this out right now. This pandemic, at least globally, feels like it's been what, 10 weeks, something like that. People are trying to figure out what to do. To Jochen's point, like people are feeling isolated. They want to have some sort of connection. So then we sort of over, we jump into these things that don't make sense, like having drinks with someone over Zoom. It's like, it's kind of a novel thing to do once, but you're like, I'll never do that again. That was kind of boring. But you know, you try it and we try it. And like, you know, so I think we're trying things out and we're pushing to see where the edges are of this thing. And I think a lot of us are going to opt out on the silly side of things pretty soon because it's not rewarding. It doesn't feel, we're trying to simulate what we know, what we've done. I think we're going to find new things to do. And then we're also going to hopefully soon enough. I mean, it might be a year. It could even be two. Who knows how long it's going to be until things, it could be longer. Could things feel back to normal, but we're going to be able to get back together again. So it's going to happen. We're just kind of on a hiatus here. We're like on a together sabbatical and we're just trying to figure out what to do with our time. So I would like, my thing is I wouldn't try to push it too hard and to make it artificial feeling because it's, we all know what that's going to feel like. It's not going to feel real. But catching up with your friends occasionally, like frankly, what I think is better is just a phone call, than a Zoom call. We want to like see each other in a sense, but it's actually kind of hard to talk to people this way. Cause for example, right now I'm not looking at you. I'm looking at this green dot on my screen. Cause that's where my eyes are supposed to be looking. If I'm looking at you, I'm looking down, which probably looks weird to you. It's like, there's all this, and you're on an iPad. The iPad camera is over on the side. So it's like, where do you look? Do you look on the side?
Yeah.
It's just talk on the phone.
Yeah.
Just talk on the phone. And I think that's what I've been doing is just having more phone calls actually, which I've been enjoying more because you can kind of, you know, do other things sort of at the same time and not feel like you're cheating somebody. When if you're trying to look at someone in the camera, like you pretty much can't do anything else. And it feels like you're too, it's too tight, you know? So that's my suggestion. Don't try too hard.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Leonie, it's a bit of a difficult question for you to answer perhaps, but I wanted to see whether you had a point of view on what Suzanne asked.
Yeah, I do, because I think that sort of stuff can't be top down. So I think the danger is in the current situation that the leader of a team feels that they must instigate a Friday night quiz or something. I think this stuff has to be really organic. And in our sort of tech teams at Dunelm over the last few years, we've worked in an agile way. And as part of that, we've had guilds where people who have similar interests, even if they don't work together, have got together on various topics. And it has been completely self-generated. And so people can participate or not participate depending on what they're interested in and their availability and so on. And I really liked that. It just felt like it was not contrived, basically, which I think is very similar to what Jason was saying. But I think, you know, there are people who have got shared interests. You have to just empower them really to feel like they can find the other people and build the bonds that way.
That's sweet. That's why you're all here tonight, isn't it? before we close, I'm going to ask each of our guest speakers to give us a sort of killer parting thought, which is always a challenge, but kind of funny. So I'll give you a bit of time to think about it, but I'll take another question. But the question I'm going to ask you is to leave us with your killer, killer practical piece of advice for all of us about how we, you know, how we don't screw up our cultures or ourselves in the coming months and weeks. But before we come to that, there was a question I really liked that my friend James Cage, you asked a question. Are you around, James?
Yes, I can ask that, yes.
On time, what the people are not doing or something. What was your question?
Yeah, I guess, you know, big change like this, which will be probably slower and take longer than we imagine it will be. It's not an immediate thing, but things like culture, leadership, the emotional intelligence we talked about are going to become more time consuming and self-conscious, I guess, for leaders. And as anything that changes and grows has to leave something behind. So what are the kind of the tropes or the assumptions or the kind of challenges of the things that we currently do when we think are normal that we're going to have to relinquish? I think Jason talked a bit about trust and presenteeism. I think Jochen talked a bit about being less task oriented. What are the other things that the other sort of assumptions we're going to have to let go of a little bit?
The one I would like to let go, well, the one we have let go of, and I'd like to see other people let go of, is this, is the necessity for immediate response. What I mean by this is when we're in a physical environment, and we're in a meeting and we're talking to someone, you kind of expect them to reply, like respond to you. Otherwise, it'd be super weird, which is okay because we're in this meeting together in this physical space. But now the same rules have applied online. What ends up happening is that if anyone reaches out to you with a question, you expect them to get back to you very quickly. And so what that does is it puts everyone on high alert all the time. And they have to stop what they're doing constantly to stop doing that to get back to someone. There's this expectation of immediate response that we've amped up communication to the point where everything is real time, everything is now. And if someone doesn't respond to my text in 3 minutes, I'll then email them. If they don't respond to my email, I'll call them to see if they saw the text in the phone call or in the email. Like, this is a broken pattern. This is not going anywhere well or going anywhere great. So I'd like to see people say, like, if someone doesn't get back to me, it's because they're busy. They're working on something that's more important than what I have to say to them. And they'll get back to me in their time. What I think we need to lose is this disrespect for each other's time and attention. We don't respect each other's time and attention. We simply don't. If we demand responses quickly and we follow up, if we don't get that, we don't respect people's time and attention. So I'd like to see that go away. And I'd like to see people respect each other's time and attention a whole lot more. Give people more time to think things through. Don't expect immediate responses. If someone gets back to you 6 hours later, that's fine. Tomorrow's fine too. Unless it's, of course, urgent, but most things shouldn't really truly be urgent anyway. So I'd like to see us let go of that.
I think that seems even more important given that everyone's home and work lives have just merged hugely. Because I bet there's loads of people that are really wrestling with that distinction. And that kind of work-life balance, you know, when does work actually stop and the home life bit start? I imagine it's harder than ever for people, partly crisis-driven, partly home is work now. So I think that's a really, you know, now more than ever, we should double down on that. It's a really good point.
Yeah.
I think it nicely feeds into that line of argument around hierarchy, because the truth is that those people who demand these immediate responses are typically higher up in the hierarchy. And they take the freedom to write and text and call whenever they want to because they believe now it's urgent. And I think it's now the time to liberate all others to reply when they think there is time for them to do so, right? So that we sort of don't create a world of freedom for the upper hierarchies to send messages and call whenever they want to, but we also create freedom for the lower hierarchies to reply and return the call whenever they want to, you know? So I think there is a real need to more equality on that. And in the same line, you know, when we're talking about, you know, when should everybody return to work? Or, you know, do we now have remote work for everyone? I think we should ask people, you know, where do you want to work? How often do you want to come to the office? You know, get some data. This is a simple survey. Just ask your people, who wants to come back to the office? How often do you want to come back to the office? How much time do you want to be having at home and so on? We'll factor this information in to our decision as to when we'll resume our office work and so on. So I think, you know, some of these decisions are not just tough calls from the top. They really can be a democratic exercise whereby you ask your own people, you know, what do you want? And then react accordingly.
That's pretty good. So look, I think we're pretty much at 7 o'clock or 2 p.m. I guess if you're in the US, but it'd be 1 p.m. in Chicago. But guys, tell me, what if you had to give us one piece of killer advice to take away and the people here can then spread that around to people that they know, you know, something really, the one thing you'd like to give them as a piece of practical advice, what would it be? Jason, do you want to go first?
Practical advice. Well, I think it depends who you are. So if you're a leader, you need to make space for people right now. You need to let everyone know that things are in flux and we're adjusting, and you need to tamp down your expectations and even curb your ambition a bit right now. Like, I think we need to slow down a little bit, give people some space to figure some things out. You cannot just hit the ground running right now. It's just not realistic. I mean, you can wish that was the case, but that's not reality. And I think anytime as a leader, you recognize the true reality and you make that point to your team's really going to appreciate that because they probably have different expectations of what you think based on what you thought before this pandemic. But now if you go, you know, we've had to recalibrate a bit and here's where we're at now. And I expect this and expect that. For example, real quick, in our company, half of our company has kids. I've got 2 young kids at home, a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old. Most of our company half have kids. And like, I can't work full-time right now. I can't. like, it's not possible for me, and it's not possible for most of our company because we're doing childcare and helping out at home, right? So we're basically said, like, you find out what works for you. If it means 6-hour days, fine. That's fine with us. If it means 7-hour days, if it means 4-hour days, that's fine with us. We trust you to do the right thing and to find the right balance, and you work with your team to make sure everyone knows when people are available. But I can't tell you how to deal with this right now. I don't know myself. So find the right balance. And I think as a leader, that's the most important message you can give to your team right now, that you trust them, that they're not taking advantage of the situation, that you know that they have a challenge in front of them, and everyone's got to figure it out their own way. So that's what I would say for leadership.
I love it. Thank you. It's a big ask to live up to, but I think it's the right one. Who wants to go next, Jochen or Leonie?
Oh, I'm happy to take it if you go in the same order as previously and leave the last word to Leonie. The piece of advice that I would give is simple, and it comes out of a study we've done recently. And in that study, we asked people not how do you feel at work, but we asked them how do you wish to feel at work? What would you desire to feel at work? And the answers that we got back included, of course, happy and excited, but mostly appreciated. People want to be appreciated at work. And women were twice as likely to say appreciate. People want to be appreciated at work. And I think, you know, many people work in jobs that might not make them happy, might not be exciting, might not be likable at all, but they do jobs that we still appreciate. That's why these jobs are there.
Yeah.
And I think these are our times now to show that appreciation to all of them and to perhaps preserve that sense of appreciation for everyone doing the job that they do, because it's an important job so that our society can work, so that we can live the life that we do, and that we create a culture of appreciation, one in which we say thank you to one another for putting in the best we can, for doing the type of jobs that we do, even if these jobs look from the outside as if you wouldn't want to do them. That's even more than the case that you should appreciate that someone does them, you know? So my piece of advice is, as you end this call, send a message of appreciation to someone in your team, in your organization, and continue to do that over the next coming of days, because as we sit lonely in our offices, lonely in our homes, we need that appreciation more than ever.
That's very sweet. Thank you. That's spoken like a true humanist, Jochen. My children are fighting over the bathroom already, which is Leonie, have you got something you'd like to leave us with as the final point?
I really loved what Jochen said just then about, you know, appreciating people. I think I would say just be really conscious of it and of the how. So in the teams that have worked remote, that I've worked in remotely, that have worked best before, they've been following the agile model where, you know, I would say at least a fifth of time is invested into, you know, how people work, you know, the tools, the communication, constantly discussing, adjusting, improving how people work together. And I think now more than ever, you probably need to invest time in that. And I think we're all guilty of never really investing time in that. We spend all of our time on what and very little on how.
Yeah.
You know, in the agile world, you spend a fortune on having agile coaches who are just there to, you know, make sure teams are working effectively together. I'm pretty sure that traditional organizations could benefit from remote working coaches, people who are in place simply to look at how it's working and to get the feedback and continuously improve it. So I think really conscious leadership and real investment in what it feels like to be remote working for individuals is really important.
I feel, God, that was an intense session. Thank you, Jason, dialing in all the way from Chicago. Thank you, Jochen, from Germany right now, and Leonie from just across the way in London. I think I really appreciate you giving your time, and I was going to say that anyway, I promise, Jochen, today. But it's been amazing, and I feel compelled and inspired to be a better colleague and a better boss and probably a better husband, actually, but that's a story for another time. But I'd like to say thank you to all of you who've come today. I'd like to say thank you to everyone who asked a question. There was quite a funny one about, is Zoom just a TikTok for adults with less coordination? But I wouldn't ask. It's quite funny. But thank you so much. I'd love to stay in touch. We'll send a follow-up email to everybody, and please drop us a line. It's really nice to hear from you guys and to carry on the discussion. I feel sad to say goodbye, but we really should go. Thank you much. See you guys.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.